So let me start by asking this question. How many of you chose to attend this TED event? And how many of you would rather be at IKEA looking at those mattresses with unpronounceable names? And before you think of it, considering my name, I do recognize the pot kettle situation here. But the question I'm getting at is, how many of you think that you made this choice out of your own free will and not destined to be here? So I'm not going to answer that question today. What I'm going to do is give you a perspective from my vantage point as a neuroscientist, and then help you make up your own mind. So first, let's look at our brains. Our brains contain about 70 billion neurons, and these form about trillions of connections between each other, and as a unit, this is what gets information from the external world, processes it, and decides on a course of action. So let's say you smell a rose. Now, the chemicals from the rose bind to neurons in your nose, and from there, these neurons send an electrical impulse to the structure known as the olfactory bulb, and from there to the rest of the brain to give you an integrated perception of the rose, not just the smell, but all the attendant memories and feelings and so forth. So it is this basic unit of communication that I want to focus the next couple of minutes on. Let's say the green neuron that you see is the neuron from your nose, and it generates an electrical impulse, and that travels down this long cable-like structure known as the axon. When it reaches the end of the axon, it reaches a specialized structure known as the synapse, which is at the junction between this green neuron that is sending information and the gray neuron that's receiving that information. So at the synapse, the axon now releases a chemical known as neurotransmitter, and this neurotransmitter binds to its receptors on these processes of the receiving neuron known as dendrites. When a neurotransmitter binds to its receptor, there's a series of events that now converts this chemical signal back to an electrical signal that travels down the axon of this gray neuron, and so on and so forth across millions of synapses. That's the simple version. Now, there is a certain level of complexity to this, and I want to tell you three things about this. One is, every time an electrical impulse comes down the green axon, it doesn't always result in release of neurotransmitters, in which case the signal stops right there. Second, one axon releasing its neurotransmitter is not always sufficient for the gray neuron to respond. You need a number of these to release neurotransmitters within a narrow time window in milliseconds. Third, in addition to this, there are other neurons, shown in red here, that release a transmitter that are inhibitory, and as the name suggests, they prevent the gray neuron from sending its information further on in the circuit. Overlooking all this are these modulatory neurons in blue that change the strength and probabilities of all these events from happening, and therefore modulate how the gray neuron sends its information down. Clear? Well, if it's clear, no, congratulations, you just passed Neuroscience 101. Now, if it's clear as mud, don't worry. The bottom line to know is that signaling in the brain is probabilistic. Some signals travel better than the others, and the same signal will travel with different efficiency based on the state of your mind, things like attention, mood, and so forth. Now, this probabilistic brain meets a probabilistic world. Okay, and things that happen in your world are determined or influenced by things that happen in your brain. Let me give you a couple of examples. First, every time I cross a road, there is a finite probability that I'll be hit by a car. Okay, it's low, but it's finite. Now, let's assume that I have attention deficit disorder. Okay, now, the probability of me being hit by a car now goes up because I'm not focused on what I'm doing. Now let's say I take a medication for ADD like Ritalin, and let's assume that this drug works exactly as advertised. Now the probability of me being hit by a car drops down to that of a person without ADD, right? So changing the chemical nature of your brain has changed your interactions with the world, okay? And this is what many psychiatric and neurological drugs do. So let's take another example. Let's say you're depressed and you've been in bed for the last week. You're unable to engage yourself in the tasks that you're supposed to or interact with people you're supposed to. Now again, like in the previous example, let's say you took antidepressants and assume that these antidepressants work exactly as advertised. Now what happens is your mood lightens, you get out into the world, you're able to engage in tasks, you're able to socialize, meet people. Now your world has changed from this 200 square foot bedroom that you spent the last week on to the external world and a completely different set of experiences that go with you stepping out of the room. So this is what I mean by saying things that happen in your brain can determine things that happen in your world. Now the other way around is intuitively obvious to all of us. Things that happen in the world clearly affect our brains, right? Let me give you an example. Many years ago, I met this woman who stated that she hated ice creams. Okay, when pushed, it turned out that when she was 11, she was in an ice cream parlor when the person in the table next to her was violently sick and threw up on the floor. Now that experience changed her brain to such an extent that she could not bear to enter ice cream parlors or have ice cream in the future. But think about what happened as well. By doing that, she's also changed her world because her world now excluded everything that could have happened if she had visited ice cream parlors and all the experiences and people she would have met and so forth. So many of us can point to an ice cream parlor moment in our lives. But what I want to emphasize is this. It doesn't have to be something this drastic. Small things behave the same way. In fact, your brain is constantly, every second of your life, being bombarded by these events and changing accordingly, right? So let's go back to the original question, choice I gave you. Did you choose to come to the TED Talk, or would you rather have gone to IKEA? Okay, so that's the choice. Events in your world, your interactions, your relationships, all of that has biased you towards attending this particular talk, right? Now let's say you're listening to this talk, you like what you hear, then the next time somebody asks you to a TED Talk, you know, you are likely to attend it. But let's say you find my talk boring and pretentious. So the next time you're offered this opportunity of attending a TED Talk, your love for Swedish meatballs trump your desire to attend this talk, and you end up at IKEA instead. And you're sitting at IKEA eating your meatballs, you meet someone else who shares your love for meatballs, you talk with them, you engage with them, and you embark on a completely different relationship that changes the direction of your world. So now a different world, different set of experiences, all because some random person gave a bad TED Talk. Now, as you're listening to this talk, I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, but I made these choices. And so it is my own free will that determined what I did. But let me ask you this question. Is there an I that is external to your brain that's capable of imposing its will on your brain? I think the answer is no. All these decisions are probabilistic events that have happened and determine your actions at any given time. So you're constantly making choices, but these choices are not binary. So questions in life are not yes or no questions, but rather like a badly designed multiple choice question. Now, something I would be excoriated for by my students in course reviews. The question that has about five possible answers, but each of those answers have a distinct and finite probability of being right. So you didn't wake up and randomly decide to attend this event. All these events in your life and the interactions of your brain and the world led you to this event. And to paraphrase the French philosopher Jean-Paul Sartre, you're condemned to a life of choice, but these choices that you make are not of your own free will. They are not, but they are deterministic, and there is a distinct probability that these happen based on this intricate dance between the brain and the world. Okay, so it is fair to say that all of us experience our world in the first person. Okay, so does this mean now that we are not responsible for our actions? The answer is, of course not. We impose our social definitions of morality, responsibility, ethics on our brain, and our brains adapt accordingly. And we know that these definitions change in society, and as they change, so does our brain in response to these changes. So my proclivity of stealing something or donating to charity might be part of this whole probabilistic set of events that we talked about, but it is the society that determines the consequences of these actions. So let's push this a bit further. So take, for example, the societal attitudes towards drug abuse. Many years ago, when we thought that addiction was a matter of choice, when we thought that addicts could will themselves to stop taking drugs, we thought it reasonable to incarcerate these people as a means of deterring them from further drug use. But now we know that addiction is a brain disorder and that there are chemical changes in the brain that are not in control of the individual. Now we think that rehabilitation is much better option than incarceration. Now let's push this idea a little more. Now, think of the worst kind of criminal you can, irrespective of whether what led them to do what they did. We'll all agree that they need to be incarcerated, right? Now, I'll tell you that I have a drug that will reduce their reoffending rate to almost zero. Now, the question is, would you still want to incarcerate them? And if so, what purpose does it serve other than retribution? So what this idea that the brain is this big chemical soup determined by genetics and the environment does is provide us with a great sense of humility and wonder. It makes our society more empathetic, and it makes a justice system more compassionate, moving from a purely punitive system to a more correctional system. Or at the very least, we can learn to tolerate differences among each other and be more compassionate and understanding. So to sum up, you know, life is a crapshoot, but hey, isn't it such fun? Thank you.